Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome back to the Nest podcast here at West Effort High School. This is season four, believe it or not. Opened this bad boy up prior to the COVID pandemic, and here we are still kicking, still going strong. Episode one of season four, and with me, hopefully he's not on the, don't go to the full shot till he's done yawning, and he's good. And that's the voice of West Effort High School Athletics, the one and only Mr. Pat Vilary, history teacher, father, husband, jack of all trades, athletic enthusiast.
It's true.
And one of the most committed West Effort teachers that we have in this building. And PV, great to have you. Thanks for coming on with us, man. We appreciate it.
Hey, thanks for the invite.
So we're gonna talk about fall 2022, which was a phenomenal fall for West Effort Athletics. Really felt like the train was fully back on the tracks, and we were moving forward since the pandemic and operating at the level that we have always planned to and have always operated at. And Pat, you know, before we get into each of these teams individually, you know, you've been covering our games for a few years now. You jumped on board, I guess, the year before the pandemic when we started live streaming our football games, right? I think 2019-ish.
Yeah.
You know, so you kind of went through that with us and became a key part of that by bringing these games home to our people in the community. How do you feel about the fall that you were just a part of and witnessed?
Oh, tremendous amount of success. You know, historically, West Effort's strongest season has been the fall season collectively. You know, field hockey's had great success, boys soccer, girls soccer, football over the years, cross country, girls tennis, you know, sometimes doesn't get a lot of the big championships because unfortunately Haddonfield happens to be in the league and in the group and everything, and they're, you know, typically a nationally ranked team. But yeah, the fall has always been, you know, a strength for West Effort Athletics, and it felt like this year that, you know, that's back.
Yeah, the summer investment of our coaches and athletes was as hardcore as it's ever been. I mean, people were grinding on this campus to get better every day from graduation to the start of their season, and certainly paid dividends here with the accolades that we had this fall, including a state title, our second state field hockey title in school history, first since 1996, and we'll hear from Coach Stetson later. But knocking on the door of a state championship in field hockey for a number of years and brought that home, and two incredibly strong fall seasons, as you mentioned, from both boys and girls soccer. So things are certainly looking up, and it's been very exciting here. And let's kick this off by talking about our cross-country squad led by Coach Burke. In his second year, Coach Burke took over for longtime head coach Mark Drummond. And Coach Drummond still very heavily involved with the cross-country community, and Brendan was his assistant for a number of years, and Brendan took over, brought Joe Pancella on, our former Nest podcast co-host, and you know, those guys in the building, both phys ed teachers, are really doing a great job of bringing cross country back into the forefront of West Effort Athletics.
Yeah, and Coach Burke obviously has got a lot of experience coaching cross country, and his own daughter, I believe, had a great high school career at Kingsway, running. And you know, two guys, both very positive. And you and I were talking a little bit earlier. Sometimes I think the athletes in our school don't think about cross country as an option, particularly those who focus on wrestling, basketball, baseball. Cross country is a great option in the fall to stay in shape and gets done a little bit earlier. So, you know, you can make your club practice or whatever else that you're doing.
Yeah. Joe Pancella used to talk about this all the time. When you go to a cross country meet, you see Paulsboro's boys cross country team cross the finish line. It's there's a 106 pounder, there's a 113 pounder, there's a 120 pounder. It's almost a prerequisite that if you're a lighter weight, you're going to run cross country, and if you're a middle weight to bigger weight, you're going to play football, and that then we're going to send you to wrestling in shape, you know, or in shape enough that, you know, we expect you to. And you bring up a great point. Now with more and more kids doing more and more club sports, I know that it feels too much of a load to carry if you're going to be a three-sport athlete anymore. Just, we don't have many of them. So to have the opportunity to do something that's going to get done relatively quickly after school, even on meet days, you're done pretty early, and maybe a weekend meet here or there, and still be able to go to your club team, you know, that's got to be a draw. But we need more kids that are jumping on that cross-country bandwagon to stay in shape and be a part of something, earn a varsity letter. You know, I think that the leadership that they had on the team this year was outstanding. On the boys' side, Zach Asaro and Ray Senator really led that group. And Zach Asaro is the only senior on the whole squad, boys or girls. So, but I would see those guys going on runs, getting the crew together, some final thoughts before we go off, setting the tone, and they're really a mature group. So they're impressive.
Yeah, and again, cross-country, after a while, you can see the kids on the team. They're their own sort of clique.
Yep.
You know, you spend all that time together, you run together, and, you know, so you develop some bonds with some kids that maybe you didn't know or maybe you never thought that you would actually be friends with. And, you know, on the fall sports, it's just really important, especially for freshmen. You know, I'm having a freshman son at a different high school, but knowing a lot of the freshman parents here, they talked quite a bit about, you know, how great it was and how, like, to play, like, on the freshman boys soccer team, to start a few weeks early, to get to know people, to kind of acclimate to the building, that the fall sports just do a tremendous job of helping our freshmen really feel like they're a part of the community when they come to the high school.
That's a great point. So funny to see the students that are incoming freshmen that did not play fall sports try to navigate their way around the facility, and then here come the kids that have been here since June, and they know every, you know, you can ask those freshmen, where do I go and what do I do and how do I operate. And on the girls' side, Isabella Mackey comes away at the end of the season, really peaking at the right time, which is so important in the sport of cross country and track and field, where, you know, you put all these this mileage in, and Coach Burke does a great job programming his season so that these kids are peaking. And one thing that he was really proud of is their PR set in every single meet. And Izzy just kind of stole the show at the end of the year by really hitting her stride, no pun intended, in the sectional finals, where she placed and then was able to go to a state championship, which, you know, really that kicked off the trend of, okay, every team that we have is making a run in the postseason this year, and started with Izzy.
Yeah, I have her in class, and the Friday before that meet, she was nervous. I mean, if you know Izzy, she goes fast, but talks fast, walks fast. And she's like, I just got to get into the top 15. That's my goal. Really nervous. And she did. So she, like you said, she achieved her own personal goal. And another great thing with cross country is, you know, it's your own personal improvement. You know, you got to, it's not just about beating the competition. It's about improving your own times. And, you know, running, unlike a lot of other sports, it's lifelong too. So.
And a shout out to wrap up cross country, shout out to Coach Burke and Coach Banchell to show you how tight knit that group was. Every runner had a desire to go watch Izzy in the state final. So they actually took a bus with the team, even though she was the only person running, so that they could support her.
That's great.
Which is really special. I mean, how easy would it have been to say, hey, it's Saturday, I'm going to take my day, I don't want to take a 2-hour bus ride up to Holmdel, you know, to watch my teammate race. But they all did, and that was really special. So great job by cross country. And we move into cheerleading. Cheerleading headed by Coach Alyssa McClaney, already in year 6. Feels like she graduated, and the next day after graduation, she got hired as her head coach. But she has done an absolutely unbelievable job, runs a first-class organization. You know, every time, I always say this, every time I go to a Colonial Conference meeting at some point in the fall, when cheer comes up, another AD is going to talk about West Effort cheer and how we get off the bus, how we walk to the field, how we're all dressed the same, how just the first-class way in which we operate. And it was a great season for them. You know, their season's kind of put together by, we practice in the summer, we lift weights in the summer, and then we prepare for the fall pep rally, which is maybe a minute and a half performance out on the football field or the track, and then we gear up for the really big homecoming pep rally, which was really outstanding this year. She never ceases to amaze me with the program that she puts together for that homecoming pep rally.
You know, I always think one of the highlights of the football season is youth night.
Yep.
And you have all the youth cheerleaders there, and they do a great job. It's pretty well coordinated, and there had to be 120 girls there this year. It was impressive watching
that's
it.
That's right. Yeah. I'm glad you said it. So this year, I mean, my youngest, my 6-year-old, is cheering.
Yeah.
And field hockey and wrestling and lacrosse. So
that's a unique combination.
There's something about something about Tally being able to be in a cheer outfit and then take you down to the ground and pin you.
Yeah.
That pregame youth night, I almost positive when I saw the tape that there were cheerleaders from the youth to the high school going from end zone to end zone.
Yeah.
Doing one full routine. I mean, that's special.
Yeah, it was cool.
And I had the opportunity to see, I mean, she throws those, our high school kids, and our high school kids coach the youth kids. And they prepare them for their end of the year extravaganza here at the high school on a Sunday afternoon. And to see the pipeline from youth to high school is something really special that I think every team that we have really works and strives to have that kind of relationship with the youth program. Critical.
All right. And that's the end of this segment. I'll pick up from Mr. Morrell here. So when we come back, we're going to focus on two sports, girls tennis and, of course, football. Both teams having a great season. So we'll see you in a few.
And we move forward into our girls' tennis program. And PV, I'll tell you what, when you talk about West Everett High School athletics, you have to think about all the multi-sport athletes we have. And that's what this girls' tennis squad reminds me of. And it's very similar with boys' tennis as well. When Coach Ponto and I were talking about, you know, how do we continue to progress our tennis programs here, it's really, you know, in this town, you're not going to get a lot of tennis-only players. It's just not how we're built. It's about our athletes coming out, similarly to cross country, our athletes coming out and just helping us out because they want to participate in something else. And our girls tennis team is exactly that. Coached by Dorothy Ponto, who took over from Mike Seeley 2 years ago. She's really done a great job keeping the tradition of a very, very competitive team alive. This year, for the first time, her assistant was Coyote Gloucester. He is a middle school music teacher, and he was an incredible addition helping out Coach Ponto this year. The girls finished with a record of 12-7 and a Colonial Conference Patriot Division Championship. So, I mean, bringing home the hardware right out of the gate. This was the first team to work into the playoffs, and they made a run. I mean, they were senior heavy, but the one thing is that the athleticism of this group is what allowed us to be successful in the back end of the season.
Yeah, like you said, looking at some of the girls on the roster there, some softball players, right? And you've seen the same on the boys' side. When starting with Coach Seeley, when he was here, able to get a lot of soccer players, getting those numbers up to close to 35 kids on a tennis team, which, you know, when you were in high school here in 1985, that was unthinkable, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you were lucky to get, you know, 6 or 7.
Yeah, it wasn't popular.
Yeah, and so, you know, you watch it, that's coaching, and that's just part of that whole athletic community where, you know, kids want to be involved. They don't just want to go home. A lot of the kids, they want to, you know, they want to get in and get out and play, and tennis is fun.
Yeah.
So, you know, they try it, and they like it, and you know, you've seen a lot of success over the years here.
Yeah, not only is tennis fun, but the competitiveness of our kids. I mean, there are times that I'm sitting there watching a set go back and forth and back and forth, and you make that one little mistake that costs you a point that you just volleyed for, you know, a minute and a half, 2.5 minutes of work. And what I love is that you see those moments of success or failure in what's really an individual sport as much as it is a team sport. And it crosses over to their other sports. And you know, we were led by seniors Victoria Connolly, first-team All-Conference, first-team All-South Jersey Group 2, senior Melissa Blanchard, our second singles, first-team All-Conference, Julia Goldberg, another senior, our third singles, and then our first doubles, senior Caitlin Craig, junior Alexis Schlegel, first-team All-Conference, and our second doubles, Lily Huang and senior Kelly Hartman. Kelly also a catcher on our softball team. So up and down that lineup, you have multi-sport athletes who know how to compete in big-time situations. And as you mentioned in the beginning, and I hate to say it, if it wasn't for, but the reality is Haddonfield is just one of the most elite tennis programs in the country. And Jeff Holman, their head coach, does an unbelievable job over there. And we're just built a little bit differently than they are. You know, so we tend to get to that spot. You know, this year we made a run to the semis. We lost to Cumberland, but you always got to wonder, would we be able to get past Haddonfield anyway? But I think that if you look at a program that gets the most out of what we've got, it's our girls' tennis program.
Yeah, and just looking at the records, unofficially, just on NJ.com, Victoria was 9-7, which, again, first singles is very impressive. You know, and Blanchard was 13-5, Goldberg was 13-5. So it looks like they've had depth at all three sets there. So great job again by the tennis team. And, you know, the next year, as you pointed out, with senior heavy, it's going to be time for some young girls to step up and get the chance.
And we have them. You know, Coach Ponto was confident. I thought for sure she's going to be, it's going to be reloading. But she was relatively confident, surprisingly to me, that the youth we have coming up is certainly capable of getting the job done. They have to have a huge offseason. And speaking of off seasons, you know, we just started lifting weights last Monday already. We're in it now. Our football program being five and five this year in what my opinion one of the most difficult schedules in South Jersey. You know, every year there's a schedule change. You think maybe they'll lighten up on us a little bit, but certainly not the case when it comes to football. But just a great senior class, a very traditional West Effort style senior class that came up through the youth program together. Shout out to youth president Zach Knapp, who's doing a great job down there. We got another incoming class this year that I think is going to be one of the best we've had. And it was just an exciting year for that group.
Yeah, and a real easy team to root for. You know, kids got off to a rough start just on the win-loss column, right? So you come out opening night, lose to Woodbury 14-7,
yep.
And Woodbury goes on to win a Group 1 state championship. Yep. And really, you were inches away on a blocked punt from really possibly winning that game.
Yeah.
You know, I still don't know how you didn't block that punt. I have to bring that up. And, you know, you come out to, you know, a rough start and you lose to Camden, who was obviously talent-wise one of the top teams in the area. You battle back from a 1-4 start where things don't look good. And when you have senior leadership that you had with Baglevaux and Swatanski, and, you know, you have these guys coming back, and, you know, it turned out to be actually a good year for the football team.
Yeah, we're certainly headed back in the direction we want to be. Getting back into the playoffs was huge. You know, one thing that I think a lot of people take for granted, and even I did this year, was we were in such a rhythm of being in the playoffs every year that it was expected, and no one got phased when you went into playoff football. It was like, this is where we're supposed to be. Now the season has really begun. We haven't been in the playoffs for 2 years. There was COVID 1 year, and last year we didn't make it. And this year I did feel a little bit like when we got to the show, these kids were like, holy smokes, here we are. We need to do something with this. And it almost worked against us because the moment was so big and we felt like because we were there, now we're supposed to do something really special. When maybe if we just keep playing the way we were playing at that time, you know, we advanced. So, but a great Gloucester team.
Yeah, yeah. And Gloucester kind of slid under the radar a little bit, but they were strong, they were physical, and Zier Foss was a really good running back.
Yep.
I mean, so they went on to beat Haddonfield in the next round.
Yep.
Which I wasn't surprised. I don't know about you.
I wasn't surprised at all.
Yeah, I anticipated that Gloucester was going to win that game. But I think a couple things too. I think Lawrence Howard really turned it on as the season progressed. I mean, I thought he was running. It was almost like a complete different player in that Gloucester game than he was in the beginning of the season.
Yes, 100%. And you saw that happening over the season. Game by game, he'd gain confidence. I remember a big hit against Camden, and you see him get a little bit excited. Then you'd have a huge hit against Salem. And just kept, I thought on both sides of the ball, he was really solid. And you look at Alex Swatanski. You know Corey Baglevaux bleeds green. You know what you're getting from Corey Baglevaux. You look at Alex Swatanski and the play that he made against Audubon in the last game of the year to save victory,
yeah,
by chasing it down 60 yards, diving, knocking the ball at the back of the end zone. I mean, that's really what West Effort football is all about. And then, you know, what could you say about Jabril Barksdale? He's just one of the most impressive kids as a whole that we've had here in the past couple decades.
Yeah, and I mean, and again, the team lacked maybe a couple things, but overall, the attitude was phenomenal. I mean, with Jabril Barksdale and, yeah, like you said, Swatanski and Baglevaux. And that play that Swatanski made at the end of the Audubon game was, I mean, in a consolation game where it looked as if the other team was somewhat disinterested, to be honest with you,
yeah,
when it first
yeah,
started.
Yeah.
And then for him to make that play, I was up top. I didn't think he had a chance of catching him.
Yeah.
You know, but he didn't give up and was able to knock it out of his hand for a touchback at the 1 yard line. But, yeah, and even that team, they've got some really good young players. Obviously, can't skip over your kicker either. You know,
I was going to save him for last. Not that he cares. Hard for him to get excited about my. I don't know if you were in a room.
Yeah, I was in a room.
He's in a room. Quick story. And we call Brady, and I go, Brady, what picture do you like better? I got two pictures up on my screen. And he's like, do you know why you're looking at these pictures? Because I'm all South Jersey. Yeah, you're all South Jersey. Like, your picture's going up on the wall in the weight room for kids that come after you to see, and you're going to come back and show your son someday. Aren't you excited about that? All right, kicker. Just get out of here. Going to Princeton, but super proud of him. And we could have a whole separate conversation on a different podcast about this, but I think he's the greatest overall specialist that we've ever had combined. We've had some great ones.
Yeah, we've had some great kickers. We have numerous Division I kickers.
Jake Brown now.
Yeah.
Brandon Ratcliffe is kicking right now for Delaware.
Mike
Perry. Mike Perry. Mm-hmm. The list goes on and on. But
Cornelius.
I just, he just he was a weapon. Mm-hmm. You know, he was a weapon.
And he fit the style of play. You know, you guys were grinding it out. You were defensive, didn't give up a lot of big plays. And, you know, he really helped on the field position.
Yeah. So, wonderful young man. Great team. Very excited for the future. They've set the tone. You know, we have a class of 32 incoming eighth graders, incoming freshmen that will be playing for us next year, who had a great season at the youth level. So, we're hitting on all cylinders in football. And when we return, we're going to get into our boys and girls soccer team, two of the most electric teams of the fall season, and can't wait to get into that. So we will be back in a moment.
And we're back. Mr. Vilary here with Coach Morrell, recapping the fall sports season. Next up on the docket, boys and girls soccer.
I'll tell you what, similar to field hockey, when you want to feel what West Deptford Athletics is about, go watch these two teams. Grinders, physical, gritty. I don't know that either team had a ton of talent. No one real superstar, but both teams played. They made the most of everything that they had and everything that they could give. And it was a very, very exciting soccer season for both the boys and the girls. Coach McAndrew in year two, taking over for longtime coach Steve Jacobowski. And Timmy has just done an unbelievable job from start to finish since he stepped into that role. You talk about a guy that is just constantly working to progress the program. You know, he's in the weight room every single morning with his guys. They're doing futsal Fridays in the gym. I mean, they've already begun. You know, how many boys soccer teams are working right now for next year? And that's why they've had the success that they've had with what they've had. I don't think, and you know better than I do, but, you know, they have always have one, two, maybe three really solid players, but there are no big-time superstars on those squads, and Tim just gets them playing together.
Yeah, I think what Tim's strength is as a coach is he builds a community.
Yeah.
And the freshmen feel just as much a part of the program as the seniors. And so he creates this climate and environment where everybody is together. And, it's easier because he's got great kids. I mean, you know, when you're led with seniors like he has with Hartman and Zuzu Locke and like Carlo and Humes, you know, it certainly makes it a whole lot easier. And for the freshmen coming in, West Deptford as a community does a pretty good job every year of handing off about 10 to 15 kids from the youth soccer program onto the freshman team. And I think what has separated Coach McAndrew over the long term is going to be his ability to bring in those kids and make them feel like they're a part of it and to be excited about it, you know, coming in right from their freshman year. But in regards to the talent, they have talented players. They do. Yeah, I would push back a little bit. There's some really good players. Mason Quinton, as an example, is a junior. He's a really skilled player. I mean, he had 49 points, you know, and Zuzu Locke, incredibly skilled player. Hartman, Monte Carlo, really skilled players. Humes, Humes was a first team all group two.
First team all conference, first team all group selected to the Colonial Conference versus Tri-County Conference all-star game. He reminds me of like a fullback, like a bruising fullback in football. I love Humesy, man. He just gets after you.
Yeah, he's a scrappy player, but he's also got skill. You know, he plays with both feet. He can, you know, bend the ball well. So they have some really good players. Sometimes West Deptford, where we struggle is the depth. The difference between your South Jersey championship team versus the team that might not get theirs. You know, you might not have that 9th, 10th, 11th player. So you've got some young kids in positions that maybe they're not suited for. Or sometimes, and the girls may run into this also, is that you've got a lot of midfielders, but you got no defenders. Or you got a lot of defenders, but you're lacking midfield. You know, it's a group two school, so sometimes you lack that sort of balance within your roster. But yeah, the boys program this year with Gavin Zuzulak and Quentin and the two Hartmans, Nick and Jake, you know, they're talented for sure. You know, so and they got a lot of talent coming back.
They do. And when you look at their schedule, some really high quality wins for a group two school like us. You know, you beat Kingsway at Kingsway in the first round of the South Jersey Coaches Cup. And then, and probably, tell me if I'm wrong, one of the bigger wins in program history in a regular season. You know, you beat Cherokee in a very funky, you know, game gets called midway. I think we were up 1-0 when the game got called due to weather. And you're playing on the road at Cherokee. So now, you know, the game has to stop. You lose all your momentum, and a Cherokee team who thought they were going to roll over you now gets to reset and come into the next day ready for what's coming, and they're going to give you your best their best shot. And to beat them in overtime and make it to the semifinal round of the South Jersey Coaches Cup was really something special. Then you got to turn around and play Sterling again still before the end of the year, and you beat them 2-1 before a heartbreaker to Haddon Township in the South Jersey Coaches Cup semifinal. But that run right there is as impressive as a run, I think, as any team made in the regular season this fall.
Yeah, I mean, remember, Cherokee was a Group 4 state champ.
Yes.
And when, not South Jersey state champ. And they also beat Haddon Township, who was the Group 1 state champ.
Yeah.
You know, so, and to beat Kingsway, I mean, Kingsway is one of the top five programs in South Jersey right now.
Why are we able to do that?
Because we have great players.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, we have really good players. They play hard. They play together. And like the Cherokee game, you know, they got a 1-0 lead at half, and they knew, you know, that they were outmatched.
Yeah.
Cherokee was the better team, but they were able just to hold on. And I think, you know, like I said, Coach DeStefano has been there for about 12 years. He's, you know, really good, you know, with the soccer and the X's and O's. And I think the program that they've created, and they work great together. You know, I think they've been able to pull off some great wins as a result.
Yeah, there's certainly a culture in that program of regardless of opponent or the day, just going out and grinding. That's one of the things, you know, part of the reason we hired Tim to take over for Steve Jacobowski was, you know, Tim's got that mindset of, it might be snowing out, it might be hail outside, we're playing in darkness with no lights, we're playing in a back alley somewhere, we're playing the best team in the state, we're playing the worst team in the world. It never matters. Just play. Like, let's play. Let's go. Don't give me any reason for an excuse. We're just going to go out and play. And that has certainly sunk into his players.
And he's competitive. Don't let the nice guy fool you. when the game starts, he's competitive.
Yep.
But so and unfortunately, you know, their worst loss of the season happened to be in the playoffs. You know, they come out and they just did not play well against Sterling. You know, the third time they had him, and you know, it's the worst way to end the season. But you know, when you take a step back and time passes, there's a lot to be proud of. And so they had a great year, just like the girls' soccer team did, right?
Would you say, before we move on to the girls, because, I mean, you coached in the Colonial Conference for a number of years,
sure,
would you say that one of the downfalls, I mean, there's a lot of great, great things about playing in the Colonial Conference, you know, year in and year out in any sport, at the elite level, the championship level, you're going to see Colonial Conference teams there.
Mm-hmm.
But you're also going to have to see these people in the playoffs.
Yeah.
So, I mean, is that one of the downfalls?
You know, yeah, I would say.
Three times. It's almost guaranteed you're playing somebody three times, and that third time is going to be in a playoff game.
Yeah, and especially, you know, a lot of the years, Haddonfield's been the one seed. You know. So Haddon Heights has had its years, and so you get to the playoffs. And, you know, it's exciting to go somewhere new, to play somebody different, to play a kid that's a highly touted kid that you don't get a chance to see.
Yeah.
But instead, you're going back to play back in Dallas, coach, you're back to scout field for the third, you know. So, you know, you lose a little bit of the excitement. But again, in many ways, it makes it harder. So when you are successful at it, you know, there's maybe a better sense of, you know, vibe about it.
So while the boys finished 14-6-2, the girls finished 13-7-1. Another really strong season from head coach Jen DiLorenzo, already in her seventh season as head coach. Man, that has flown by. And she's done a great job putting her fingerprint all over this program. She's a 2003 grad from West Everett High School in the girls' soccer program. And, you know, they started the season really, really hot. And they rattled off 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 wins right out of the gate before their first tie. You know, what else could you say about these kids? They're just really rock solid. Another group of really rock solid kids in the building in that program.
Yeah, and some really good soccer players, you know. So when you go to that senior class with J.C. Gizmondi, you know, he's an all-conference, I believe, all-state Group 1 midfielder going to LaSalle next year. Great player, great athlete, high-character kid. You got Lexi Yeager up top scoring goals, and you got Ryan Iannotti in goal. So, I mean, you've got the depth and experience at many different positions. You got Acevedo, who's a highly skilled player, was on the outside, I believe, on the attack quite a bit. And then you got, you know, you got a lot of speed with Barford and Janie Cross. And, you know, just a ton of speed on that team. So, you know, unfortunately, Sterling this year was really good, and they were somewhat of a roadblock both in the conference and in the playoffs.
You know, I think there were a lot of role players on that team that did exactly that played their role and they took pride in that. You mentioned Rachel Barford. I think on the back end, you know, Janie Cross was a ball hawk on defense. Little Ava Yatesy. Yeah, Yatesy was back there, you know, gritting and grinding it out. And he had Michaela Scarrata, who shut a lot of people down.
Tough.
You know, yeah. Very, very physical, very tough, but very level-headed. And it was, I mean, talk about last year's team compared to this team. Last year, we were a little bit bigger, a little bit taller. You had Olivia McGee back there kind of run the show, and you transferred from 6'1", you know, and some other close to six-footers around her to some you know, short, very fast, very quick, you know, pit bulls back there that just get all over you. Were you surprised with the success that the team had this year? Did you anticipate it?
No, yeah. I was, having done both playoff games last year, I was really impressed with their overall team speed and the depth. You know, they had a lot of underclassmen playing, and unfortunately sometimes height, I didn't see a ton in the girls' games, but a lack of height on the back end makes you vulnerable. Corner kicks and restarts, and you know, they did give up some goals this year, and I would imagine quite a bit was probably maybe struggling to win balls in the box. I'm just guessing, right, looking at the height. I mean, Scarrato's, I mean, she's a tough physical girl who's going to win balls in the middle. But so, yeah, but I think ultimately, like you said earlier with the Colonial, a lot of the times it just lines up with, you know, the what I understand, Sterling has a lot of girls who have had a lot of success at the club level, who've played together. And, you know, we had them in the playoffs. I don't want to bring it up. Lost some penalty kicks. It was a heartbreaker.
One of the most special moments of being in this athletic department in the last 10 years, and if you ask me for a defining moment, was that, you know, we're live streaming that game. Shout out to WDTV 08 and Mr. Kirshner for being able to live stream from just about anywhere. I'm pretty sure we're live streaming from the moon next year. But it's going into PKs, and I look, we're in the middle of football practice. I look next door, and Coach Stetson has the whole field hockey team is surrounding this speaker. And they're cheering, and they're cheering. I'm like, what the heck's going on over there? And I'm like, Court, what's going on? We're watching soccer and PKs right now at Sterling. Whole football team. So now you have 120 athletes around these two little phones watching this live stream. They connected the one phone to the speaker, and everybody was invested in it. And I think that's part of the reason we've had the success we had this year. This senior class is really tight-knit. I mean, they are a really quality group of kids, and the way that they pull each other and pull for each other, and the way that they, you know, the example that they're setting for the underclassmen of what it means to be a student athlete here and the support that you're going to get was really special.
Yeah, and again, that translates. Having taught a lot of them last year's juniors, some excellent students.
Yeah.
You know, you talk about Brady Clark, who's going to Princeton, I believe, right? Yep. Paige Jakowski, you mentioned in the field hockey segment, incredible student. Kelly Levengood, there's so many, I couldn't mention them all. And, you know, that discipline in the classroom usually carries over to the field, so.
Yeah, so the girls losing second-round PKs. I mean, it just makes no sense to me why PKs are even a thing. It's absolutely ridiculous that you play that hard for that long, and now it's going to come down to that kind of situation.
Yeah, and it goes down as a tie.
Right.
You tie, but the other team advances.
Right.
And, you know, you feel bad as an adult because somebody's going to feel terrible at the end.
Yeah.
You know, and you just watch World Cup. Harry Kane, I'm sure you were watching. Coach Morrell, you know, missed the PK against France on Saturday. He's a world-class player. You know, he hit one earlier in the game. So just to point out that, hey, you may not make it, but that happens to even the best of them. But, unfortunately, the game has to end. So,
and, you know, Coach DiLorenzo has done a great job, you know, making that, even that area over there, that girls' soccer field, feels more like their arena. You know, they got their senior pictures up on the fence. They got flags up over there. It feels very much like their home turf. And they actually played, they were outstanding on their home turf. I think they were 9-1 or 10-1 at home.
Yeah.
So being in the nest, certainly, you know, there's a feel here where there's a home field advantage, and gritty and physical and aggressive is the way I define that team. And Coach DiLorenzo says, hey, guess what? We're only going to get better.
Yeah.
You know, when I think of Lexi Varela, freshman, yep, phenom, and a lot of pieces surrounding her that are going to make that team even better moving forward. So a great season by girls soccer, and for our soccer program in the township as a whole is really hitting on all cylinders right now.
Yeah, and Varela, of course, 11 goals as a freshman. So, you know,
pretty good.
Got a bright future there.
Pretty good. I mean, what did you have, 9-10 when you were a freshman?
No, I was playing football as a freshman, believe it or not.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's right. Couldn't hack it. All right.
Too boring. I got a question for you then.
Hit me.
Play of the year in the fall. I've got a few that come to mind. All right, football, off the top of my head, either Swatanski's track back against Audubon or the interception against Paulsboro.
Oh, it's got to be the Audubon play, no doubt.
The boys' soccer, Mason Quinton beating Sterling in overtime with a shot about 27 yards out.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, 100% agree.
Field hockey, McGivern's game winner against Shore.
Easy. I mean, that'll be one of the most iconic moments until we win the next one.
All right.
Girls' soccer.
I didn't see a lot of their highlights. You got to help me out on that one.
Girls' soccer. Oh, man, I'm thinking about night game. Malia Acevedo against Haddonfield.
Yeah, very skilled player.
Burying one from like 30 yards out, top right-hand corner. I have to go back and check me on that one to make sure it was Malia, but somebody buried one from way downtown that had no business. You have to get Mike Pusty in here to show our physics teacher to show me how that ball was able to come back down out of the air and get into the back of the net.
And it's we're giving some tips for Mr. Kirshner for the end of year sports highlight video. All right, laying this out. So hopefully he's taking notes back there.
And with that, we will be back, and we're going to bring in state championship head field hockey coach Courtney Stetson to wrap up this show. When you win state titles, you get on the podcast, period.
You still haven't explained why I'm here then.
It's comic relief, like I just keep saying. So we'll be back after this to wrap up with head coach Courtney Stetson. And we are back on the Nest Podcast, Episode 1, as we wrap up the fall. And who better to wrap up the 2022 West Effort fall sports season than the one and only West Effort alum, West Effort head field hockey coach, West Effort field hockey state champion coach, Courtney Stetson. Coach, welcome to the Nest.
Thank you so much. Happy to be here.
When you bring home state titles, you get podcast airtime. All right.
If only I had known before.
then why am I here?
It's just your voice.
Comically. All right, Coach. 18-4-1. The whole world knows that you brought home our second state title in school history, the first since 1996. We've been on the doorstep time after time after time. How many conversations have we had about when are we going to get over the hump? And not only did you get over the hump this year, but you did it by beating one of the best teams traditionally in the state. It's not like Shore Regional was one of the best teams this year. They're every year one of the best teams in the state. And what I think, and where I'd like you to kind of start our conversation is, and you and I spoke about this, last year was not the best year for West Effort field hockey.
True.
But we felt like you wanted a schedule that was a steel sharpened steel schedule. When I sit down with the coaching staff and I say, okay, well, how do we want to build the out-of-conference schedule? You specifically said we want hard teams, and that's what we got. And they weren't teams that we matched up well with, but there's not a doubt in my mind that this senior class and the kids that returned this year benefited from last year's schedule this year.
certainly this year's senior class, I think, kind of saw everything they could across the state. Over their 4 years, we played Eastern, played Camden Catholic a couple times, Rancocas Valley, Clearview, always a great competition. So I think that slowly they were preparing so that by the time we got to this year, they knew what it took, even if they lost, because we took some losses. This year, they finally learned how to battle back, I think.
Yeah, and when you look at the top three out of the four state finalists were from Gloucester County. West Effort, Clearview, Kingsway. Two of those three won. And Camden Catholic.
And Camden Catholic.
Catholic in a parochial.
Yep.
Yeah, it's Camden County.
Yeah. Thanks.
That's why I'm here.
But,
legitimate South Jersey.
It's really, really impressive. And when you look at the way that you did it, round one, 8-0 win over Bordentown. Round two, 4-2 over Woodstown. Round three, a semifinal against Haddon Township. Third time we played them, which
always
is
hard.
Always awkward and a little bit uncomfortable, and a shutout there, and then a sectional final win playing Collingswood for a third time and getting a 2-1 overtime victory. Talk about playing teams three times, and Coach, I'm going to, PV, I'm going to get your input on this too, going back to your coaching days. What are the challenges that you face having to beat a team or play a team a third time in that setting? It's not like, you know, I know we had to play Haddon Township in the Coaches Cup for the boys soccer, but this is, it's do or die.
You know, both of them are so different. The Haddon Township game, number one, we have a great relationship, that coaching staff and my coaching staff. So it's always very lighthearted, but we both knew coming in that everything was on the line. And the second time we played them in the season, we really brought it down to, I think, within 30 seconds to pull that win out. So really the girls just kind of, they sincerely bought into playing a new season in playoffs. And that's what it took. So shutting that team out was a great step in the right direction to get to Collingswood. Collingswood's a whole nother issue. Incredibly strong team this year. And that was real. I mean, I know it was only our second to last game, but that was the second to best game that the girls played this year. They really played together. They played hard. They dominated. We struggled a little bit scoring, but finished it when we had to.
Yeah. Pat, talk about how difficult it is playing a team a third time in that kind of setting.
Well, I think the big factor is whether or not you've won the first two games. I think when you've won the first two, the challenge is getting your girls, your team, absolutely, motivated for that third match. When you've lost twice to them, the motivation's there. You know, you don't have to come up with the motivation as much. So, you know, that mental sort of focus that you might be concerned about in that third game, I think depends on where it went the first two. And the other factor always is, too, like, what is the reputation of that particular team that season? You know, if you're playing a team that is, you know, ranked top in South Jersey, you know, versus a team that might be ranked 15th, you know, the mindset's a little bit different. You know, you might be a little bit more intimidated if they're being recognized as the top team in the area and you've lost to them twice already. So, you know, how much your team believes you can beat them versus how focused you can keep your team if you've already beaten them a couple of times. That's the big challenge.
Yeah, so, you make a great point. The Collingswood game was, you know, who's going to take it all, because we split in the season and then we ended up being co-conference champs. So this was really like, who's going to be the team this year?
Yeah, and it was physical games too, from what the girls were saying.
Oh, so, yeah.
Always is. It always is. I mean, and that's exciting and nerve-wracking simultaneously. And what's really interesting is to see the difference in the team that you play. And, you know, I think it's, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but we've always had a more physical and aggressive style of play and kind of play right on that edge where, you know, we're playing to win, but we're keeping it right at, on the line. And in games like that, in sectional final games, it gets dicey. So, because sometimes you got to adjust. I mean, you get the wrong officiating crew that doesn't appreciate, understand, or know your style of play, and that's how two teams are going to go, and officials have to make decisions. Are we going to let it ride, or are we going to call every single thing that we see and try to force these people to adapt to us? I don't know if you ran into that during that, or if you felt that at all during that game.
I definitely agree with that. And I would say that something that I tell the girls, and I know that they believe in, is I don't want them to start the physical game, but I never want them to back down from it. You know, so if that's how the game's going to go, then they're going to hold their own, and they don't cross the line, but it is toe to toe.
On the other side of it too is, you know, physical play. When you cross that line, you're penalized.
Absolutely.
You know, and your game winning goal. And we go man down. And the game winning goal was a penalty corner, correct? Was against Shore?
Oh yeah, it was. Yep.
So I mean, you know, the when things get physical, emotions get take over. Focus gets lost, bad penalties happen on your defensive third, and you end up in bad spots.
Yeah.
So
when I think about the 22 field hockey team, I think about even keeled. It was one of the most mentally and emotionally balanced teams that I've seen us put forth from this athletic department. And there were some youngsters. Like, when you look at the list of seniors, it was there's a lot of quality in that senior class. You know, Nat McGivern's one of the best we've had. Ava got hot at the end of the year, and we don't do what we did without her getting hot at that time of the year. Kelly Levengood, which we'll get to later. We made a big coaching decision by moving her back to defense, where we'll get to in a minute. But when I look at the other names here, that's who I was most impressed with from the sideline, is some of these youngsters that had to go out in a big-time situation and never let the moment get too big. Cassia Russo comes to mind right away. Callie Christie.
Solid.
Just solid. She's a sophomore, right? Russo is a junior. And then Zoe Gibbons, you know, Straczynski, Julia Stewart, some of these freshmen. I mean, this freshman class really is loaded, and they were all on the field.
In overtime.
In overtime. And Pat, you would never know that they were freshmen just by the way they carried themselves and the way they competed on the field. It was really impressive.
Yeah, Julia Stewart became a starter after, I think, game four. And I don't think I ever took her off the field pretty much after that. And we just had a conversation recently, but there's nothing incredibly striking about her. She sits in, she does her job, she puts her stick down, she takes the ball from their best players, and then she gets rid of it. There's nothing snazzy about her. She just does her job, and there's no reason to ever take her off the field if she's doing what she's got to do. As a freshman, a 13-year-old winning a state championship.
Yeah.
So, question for you, though. You know, you mentioned earlier that we had lost in the state semifinals.
Seven years in a row.
So what is the difference with this team that you see? What allowed this team to overcome that this year? What was unique about the 2022 team?
Well, I mean, I can't not mention that changing the groups was a game changer for them. I think mentally more than competition level, because like Jason said, Shore is a top team every year in the state. What we ran into consecutively was the same team repeatedly in playoffs, and that became a mental barrier, I think, more than a talent or physical barrier. So that definitely kind of opened them up. They're like, okay, we can do this. This is a new opportunity. And then with COVID happening and the format changed a couple times, these kids, they won a sectional championship as freshmen. And then we had two really tough seasons where we had to work to break 500. And I think that helped them learn how to fight, you know, learn how to want the win and not just be complacent with, yeah, we were okay.
Yeah.
I want to go back to Kelly Levengood going back to defense, and you don't have to get into a ton of details here, but it's not always common in today's day and age that when you tell a starter, we're going to move your position because it's what's best for the team, that you always get automatic buy-in. I mean, right now there are like 1,400 football players in a transfer portal because they're not getting the playing time they want at the college level. I mean, and there's going to be a trickle-down effect that we've already felt, where there are a lot of student athletes today, unfortunately, that feel like it's owed to them their position on the team. And to ask them to do something that's uncomfortable for them but best for the team has the potential to become a disaster. That was a huge move, moving Kelly back. Why did it go so well? How did you ensure that move went so well?
I think the one component our defense was missing was just kind of like a power player, not necessarily a defender, because like you said, Callie Christie was a solid defender. Kelly brings a presence that we were missing. So she's vocal and she's unafraid and she's unrelenting. So if she gets beat, I know she's going to do her job to get back. And a lot of conversations we had with the team was making sure we're putting the team first. And Kelly really bought into that about halfway through the season. And she knew our defense needed help, and she was grateful to be that player.
I mean, it's special now when you see that.
She was a forward last year.
Right.
First team all conference, forward.
Forward. So I'm scoring goals all the time.
Yep.
That's my job, is to score goals. And I'm going to get moved to the exact opposite. Now I don't get to score any goals. I just got to keep the ball from going in that.
Yep.
And sometimes, too, Kelly's sorted out her college, like where she's going.
Yep.
So when you get that figured out, your next step individually, then you can really zero in and focus on the team. And
I think that helped Kelly a lot, not having to have that stress. You know, that was finished before the season started. So you're right. She just got to play and enjoy her senior season and do whatever the team needed her to do.
And again, in any field sport like that, though, anytime you have a defensive player with a high skill level who's still composed,
you
can link better through the midfield. You know, sometimes people assume that your less skilled players are going to be on the back line, but not always the case. And when you get that, you possess more, you play better. And you can see in the games I watched on the live streams. I mean, she got back, she communicated, she sees the field.
She's just a presence. Because of that communication, she understands the game.
Mm-hmm.
I think she made the younger players, because we did have a lot of younger players specifically on defense, she made them feel a little bit at ease because they knew that she had the experience that they were sort of missing.
Right.
I think it just calmed them.
If they make a mistake, she can help cover.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So last two bullet points here for you. Number one, talk to us about your senior class and what that senior class meant to this program. Your first senior class.
These are my first.
That's what's special about this. Yeah.
It is. They're super special. They all kind of bring their own components to what makes the team special. you know, some girls just kind of fly under the radar. The girls that don't get the playing time, they're equally as important to the team. They're the spirit from the bench. And then we've got like our quiet leaders. Laura Wilson decided, I think, this time last year that she really wanted to make her senior season matter. So she came in and she was the kind of leader that doesn't get credit for a lot, but we named her captain because the girls looked up to her. She was a voice at practice. And she is a reason that the class changed. She doesn't have all the stats. She just came in and she played her last season for her team. Of course, we have power with Nat McGivern, who's one of the most talented players. Obviously, Kelly and Ava was just lights out in playoffs. I just feel like it all kind of clicked for them all at once. And all of our end of season conversations, they just said, like, they just kind of decided we're not ready to be done yet. And that was their choice. You know, like, we hit a point in the middle of the season where it could have gone the other way. And because of this class, I think they really pulled everybody back around. They're super special.
This wasn't my second bullet point, but I'm going to throw it out there. Put you on the hot seat.
Okay.
The original shark, Jess McGivern,
yeah.
Indiana University, mm-hmm. or little shark, Nat McGivern, you can only pick one to go into a state championship game with.
This is mean.
We can always edit this out.
I love them both.
We don't love it.
I would choose Nat.
Really?
Yeah. Jess is a shark because of her grit.
Yeah.
I think. Nat had to learn that. But I think that she learned it this year, and Nat's talent is incredibly high.
Jess, I would pick you if you're out there listening. That's where you're at. And my last question for you, and then PV, if you have anything to add, what does the future look like for West Effort Field Hockey with what you have coming back?
I feel like people would assume that, you know, next year would be a down year just because of what we are graduating in the talent of the senior class. But I think the future is bright. I have a lot of underclassmen returning, particularly in that sophomore and junior class, with experience. You know, what the coaches and I typically do when the season ends, we immediately start to build our lineup for the next year. And we haven't been able to do that yet because there's actually too many options, which I like. Something that Ponto and I learned this year is that your lineup's not set. You know, once you come in the season, it's not set. I think that's something that we've really had to learn several times, but I think that opens up a lot of opportunities for these kids coming in. So they're going to have to work for it, but there's a lot of talent that's coming in, and now they know what it feels like to sit at the top, and I don't think they want to let that go.
And you're going to be on your fourth goalkeeper in 4 years next year.
Yep.
I mean, shout out to Paige Dukowski, who just
incredible.
Unbelievable.
On could the have heels never of, written that.
DeRossini
predicted
on
it.
The heels of Gismundi. I mean,
yep.
It's pretty special.
Yeah, she had a huge save against Collingswood, I believe.
She had a couple.
Yeah, it was like a counter where the girl was actually behind the defense, and Paige came off the line and made a huge save.
She was game changing for us this
Super
year.
Super vocal.
Mm-hmm.
Another senior. I can't believe I didn't mention her. Almost zero varsity experience coming in to the season, and her vocal leadership, her positivity is just like contagious.
Yeah.
So adding Kelly to that back line for Paige helped Paige also, she shared. You know, it made her more comfortable knowing that she had that with her. But yeah, she was just so great stepping into huge shoes, and she did that beautifully.
Yeah. I also noticed too, in the first question, Mr. Morrell here was crediting himself with making the schedule that made you ready for a state championship. I'm not sure if you caught that. I caught a tone of like him trying to glean a little bit of credit for your success. But I think I think I had more to do with you and the girls.
I said we, first of all. And I did hear you say, quick subject change, Ponto, were you referring to Coach Sidney Ponto?
I was, yes.
Should Tom Jacobowski, her husband, just change his last name to Ponto? Because I feel like no one will recognize her as Sidney Jacobowski, but I would definitely call him Tommy Ponto in 2 seconds. Coach, congratulations. We'd be remiss if we didn't mention that you were honored as Coach of the Year by NJ.com and the Colonial Conference. So you've made us as a high school, as a school district, as a school community, very, very, very proud with your accomplishments this year. Great job in only year 4, so great things to come. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming on the show today.
Thanks, guys.
All right. When we come back, we will wrap up Podcast The Nest Episode 1 right back here. All right. Thank you, Coach Stetson. Great job. Congratulations one more time on that state title performance this year. Mr. Vilary, thanks so much for being a part of this thing, man. It was awesome having you. You're the voice of the Eagles. Seriously, though, you do. I can't tell you how many, how many people come up to me and say, man, I watched that football game on Friday night from the MRI or Shalene's pub or from my, you know, my living room, and it's better than most of the games I watch on Saturday and Sunday. I mean, obviously Mr. Kirshner, Mr. Dixon, and that whole crew, you guys have done an unbelievable job bringing our athletics into the homes of not only our community, but, you know, there's people in other countries that are listening to you on a Friday night. So thank you to you so much. Really appreciate it.
Not a problem. It's always a blast.
And hopefully we'll get you back in some basketball games this winter. Nothing like you and I doing a basketball games together. It is truly like, Mr. Miyagi and Danielson. So it's been a great fall. We cannot wait for the winter to kick off. And again, thank you to Mr. Kirshner behind the scenes, the magic man doing his thing for WDTV 08 and our entire community. I am Mr. Morrell signing off. We'll see you on episode 2.